Welcome back to IATEFL Online Harrogate. I'm joined today by James Taylor, Katherine Bilsborough and Willy Cardoso. Welcome and thanks for taking the time to come and speak to us. We're looking today, or we're talking today about blogging in general. I know the three of you write your own, keep your own blogs and write your own blog posts. What we kind of, the angle we'd like to look at really is more from an audience point of view, I think. And for you three, what do you think are the benefits for teachers reading your blogs? What do they get from it?
Well, when I first started blogging, it wasn't for anybody else but myself, because I didn't think that anyone would read it. But then after some time, you keep going at it and people do start to read it. And then I think what happened over time was that I found I was getting feedback from the people who were reading it, leaving comments, and you know, sometimes letting me know I was wrong or helping me improve a little bit and more, you know, focusing my ideas. And I think that kind of feedback is very rewarding, not just for me, but also for the people who are giving the feedback as well. So I think that's the main thing I get out of the process of blogging. And yeah, as I said, I hope it's useful for the people who read it and read the comments as well.
I actually haven't got my own blog at the moment. It's something I've been thinking about for some time, but because I have been a bit nervous about whether I could actually keep it up, I haven't started it. So I've started blogging for the Teaching English site, made a commitment to blog every month, and my idea is if I do that consistently for the next 12 months, I'll feel like I'm able to blog myself. But I really enjoy reading other people's blogs, and I think teachers, I think you need to find the right blogs, because there's lots out there. Obviously the Teaching English one is good because you've got so many people blogging on it, so there's lots of different ideas. And I would say there's a lot of thought-provoking things out there, which maybe we'll talk about a bit more.
We'll come back to that. Thanks, Willy.
For me, I think at the beginning it enabled me to have a sort of conversation that I couldn't have elsewhere, or face to face with my colleagues where I was working in Brazil. So I started to read lots of blogs and to write my own, but at the beginning I probably visited and commented on more blogs than actually writing my own blogs. And the quality of the conversation at the time, it was incredible for me, considering a context without too much resources or information coming in very easily. Yeah. Going online and finding people who were open to, you know, answer some questions I had about methodology or shared some concerns, it became very, very, very useful for my professional development. So that's from my, as a perspective, a reader of blogs. Yeah. Because I've always read books, but then you don't usually write the author a letter.
No.
And, you know, and with blogs, many authors blog.
Yeah.
So you can go and you can ask, I don't know, Jeremy Harmer or Scott Fungry a question, and they reply. And the beginning's like, whoa, you know, I can actually speak to these guys.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And then I started to take them as models, and I started to develop my own blog.
Yeah.
And then, it's been like 3 or 4 years now.
I'd like to ask a question from the point of view of the Teaching English Facebook page, because that's really come alive thanks to people like you who put blog posts on it, and they've been incredibly popular. But it's quite a strange issue, because the biggest audience for the Teaching English Facebook page are non-native speakers in countries like India, Vietnam, Southeast Asia, maybe South America as well, rather than European countries. And I look around and most of the bloggers are from European countries. So with that mix of people who are blogging and the audience, how do you think your blogs are being, why are your blogs being successful across that broad spectrum of teachers?
Well, I think there must be a cultural aspect within European or American countries compared to the rest of the world. I'm not sure why that is, but I think there are certain types of professional development. I mean, if you live within Europe, then professional development is very easily accessible.
Mm-hmm.
You know, conferences like this, and there are conferences like this in pretty much every country in Western Europe and beyond. So you're around that scene a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
And it may well be that, that it's less accessible in those places.
Mm-hmm.
I'm guessing, but I think that may be a possibility.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then I guess if you're in one of those environments, then you're going to crave it more.
Mm-hmm.
And so an access, a resource like the Teaching English Facebook page is invaluable, because it's easy for people to just scroll through that page and find a wealth of material. You know, it's just so easy because they're already on Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it bridges that gap. But then whether you can get people to then go to the next stage and start creating and writing themselves, that's a big step. And
yeah.
I would love to see more people doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to see it be a lot less Eurocentric.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I imagine that part of the success of the blogs just is a natural carrying on from the success of the website. So it doesn't surprise me at all. So, it's just fantastic, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And even though these people might not be writing their own blogs, they are responding to these. They might not have their own blogs, but they're writing on blogs.
Mm-hmm.
Does it really matter?
Mm-hmm.
Does it really matter?
Mm-hmm.
I suggested in my talk the other day that if somebody wanted to get involved in writing blogs, that they start off by gate crashing another blog or saying, look, I'd like to write something for your blog. Because I can't imagine anybody with a blog turning them down if they write something that's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
why would you?
Yeah. I would add that the appeal is also in the language of blogging, in a way. It's fairly different to books, the way you would read books on methodology, for example. It's very conversational in a way. Some bloggers, not all, but and that is interesting because it's like you're having a conversation of sorts. Whereas if it's even online, if it's a more academic publication, let's say, people feel intimidated to comment, and you know, because you have that invisible hierarchy of the expert and
mm-hmm.
the reader,
mm-hmm.
whereas the genre of blogging invites you sometimes
mm-hmm.
to interact.
Yeah.
So that there's that appeal,
mm-hmm.
I think.
I mean, I think it's true. I mean, coming back to the point that you made earlier, sometimes I find the actual comments on the blog post more interesting than the blog post itself.
Yeah, certainly.
I mean, it's interesting, we haven't got a lot of time left, but just, and this is a really interesting conversation, we'd like to take it on, but I mean, you've all kind of touched on this idea of dialogue, and for me, I think that's one of the great things about blogging as opposed to writing a book, is that's what it is. It's almost an invitation to enter into a dialogue.
Yeah. I think there's a reason why a lot of bloggers would look at their blog posts and they'll be disappointed there are no comments.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's not because he wants to feed your ego and go, oh, it means loads of people like it.
Mm-hmm.
It's because you want people to come back to you and let you know what they think about it.
Yeah.
Can I briefly add something?
Sure.
With Facebook being that incredible in terms of the power of being able to network with people from all over the world. On the other hand, I felt that as we moved on into Facebook,
mm-hmm.
the as a consequence, it's like only culture. You like the blog. Whereas like 3 years ago, I felt I was having more conversations, and today it's just easy to like.
Mm-hmm.
And that,
mm-hmm.
you know, is very positive, but we have to
mm-hmm.
think about that.
Yeah.
Just liking, is that some sort of interaction?
Yeah.
Well, it's not really. You know.
Yeah.
Sure.
So I would ask readers and bloggers to, you know,
okay.
interact.
I actually read Willy's blog in the, was it March for the
Teaching English
about the conferences, and Willy wrote about he doesn't like it when he goes to a talk and the speaker asks him to do pair work because Willy wants to get the expertise from the speaker, and there are time and place for pair work, but maybe not there. And as I read it, I thought, oh God, please don't come to my session at IATEFL because I was going to do pair work. And I carried on reading down, and it was quite thought-provoking. And so reading his blog post actually had a direct impact on my presentation here. because it made me think about the questions I was asking people to talk about. So it, you know, it's just great.
Yeah, it
all this learning from each other.
Lots of levels,
it's fantastic.
Isn't it? Okay. Yeah. Great. Thank you. We've run out of time, but James, Kath, Willy, thank you very much for joining
thank
us.
You. Thank you.
We'll be back later. We'll be Gavin Dudney. We'll be talking to Graham Hall next.